I was thinking to myself, all right, another sushi restaurant. Well, he took me to a little place on Lomita Boulevard, totally nondescript little place in a little mini mall, miniature mini mall. And we rolled up, we had a business discussion, we walked in, there's this little counter, and how many seats were there?
Five seats.
Five seats. And I was just saying earlier to Trini, next to the sushi counter, there's a little stainless steel sink that you could walk up and wash your hands in. So I happen to like that. It was just one of those nice little side notes. So after going there once or twice and not only having the pleasure of eating phenomenal sushi, I was introduced to Travis, who was the owner of that place. And the name of the establishment was Kamiyama Sushi. So I would go in there periodically. We developed a relationship. He already had a relationship with my customer. And over time, we kind of got to know each other. And at some point, when I first became involved with this organization, which is now like 10 years ago? 12 years ago. At some point, we got to talking, and he's Travis, awesome guy, and I somehow shared this experience, the boarding house mentor's experience, and what I was doing. And I don't know if I asked him and solicited him, because I'm a salesperson by heart and by training, and so I may have solicited him, or he may have volunteered. I don't remember. But he's such a good guy and such a phenomenal human being that it's entirely possible that he just volunteered. So irrespective of how we arrived at this place, he decided to make himself present many years ago to come here and provide us with an opportunity on the beach to serve, not only serve sushi, but talk about the process of bringing a very unique and phenomenal food product and experience to us, to all of us. And so when I first met Travis, he was a young entrepreneur. He had a startup business, five seats at his sushi stand, and always had impeccable customer service, was a wonderful individual to interact with. He remains that way. Obviously, he's here after all these years. But one of the things, for those of you who don't know this about Travis has traveled, had an amazing life path. He went from that small business to becoming not only the owner, but the manager of a monstrous sushi enterprise, which is international now. Over the course of 14 years, he's recognized, particularly in the cruise industry, as the guy. He is the sushi chef within the cruise industry. He's catered for the Dodgers, he's catered for Toyota. He's done work for extremely high-profile individuals and companies. He was the one over the last couple of years that made the radical change. For those of you guys who've been to the Hollywood Bowl before, he's responsible for all the changes in the menu and what happened at the Hollywood Bowl. So we have a phenomenal individual, a phenomenal sushi chef, and a phenomenal story that joins us every year, Travis Kamiyama, who's come to talk to us about sushi. So if we can all give him a round of applause, that would be awesome.
Okay. Well, guys, it's actually my pleasure to be here. You know, I'm always like busy doing business stuff and you know, expanding the world and stuff. But my true passion is about giving back, and it's about leadership and such. You know, I'd like to see young people develop and succeed over the years. So let me ask you guys. Some of you guys are early teens, maybe under 10. Who has a dream? Who has a dream to be somebody or something? Does anybody have a dream to be somebody, something? What about you? What do you want to be?
To be an engineer.
Engineer, all right. What specifically? What engineer?
Just.
Yeah. Okay. An engineer. That's pretty good. How about you?
Architect.
What's that?
Architect.
My gosh. Wow. Anybody else, like a sports athlete or astronaut or anybody like that? How about you?
Pilot.
Like an airplane pilot. Commercial?
Yeah, probably.
Commercial pilot, huh? All right. Anybody else? No, but hey, you know what? Without dreams, guys, you can't really go far, okay? So my passion and my dream was found out at the age of 14. Basically, I loved art and I loved people. So what did I do? This is art. This sushi? It's all basically art. You're not cooking anything. It's all about angle. It's about cutting. It's about precision. So I took something that I truly love, and then I also put a why to it. You can't just have a dream without a why. Like why for? What's your purpose, right? So So you combine the passion and your dream together with why, you know? Why for me is leaving a legacy. It's basically, I can't be the only one successful in this, you know, in this world, just about, you know, collecting all the money or collecting all the clients or expanding throughout the world. I have to also, you know, have a reason. What can I give back to the people? And this is one way of giving back to the community of my time and my talent to some of you who probably has never had sushi before. And of course, to all the volunteers that usually know what sushi is about, right? So this is one form of doing that. So today, I just want to leave you with some key things that, you know, I want you guys to take with you. The passion plus the why, okay? So figure that out. If you don't have a dream yet, find out as quickly as you can, okay? And don't let other people tell you what to do or what to be. You know, try to find out for yourself what it is that, you know, you like to do, okay? Because that's the most powerful thing. When you go to work every day, you know, like, when you're an adult going to work 9 to 5 and stuff like that, if you don't like what you're doing, wow, it's gonna be a tough one, guys. You know, you gotta really like delve into it and make sure that it's not like really work. It's something that you love and that you're passionate about, you know? Whether it's an architect, a pilot, you know? Whatever that is that says, okay, why do I wake up every day to do that, you know? So make sure you find that out. And then secondly, it's to take action, guys. If you don't take action, because, you know, let's say you go to school and you have all this knowledge, but if you don't take action and apply it, it means nothing, guys. Knowledge is potential power. But true knowledge applied through action is powerful, okay? And then perseverance, don't ever quit, guys. Perseverance, how long has Boarding House Mentors been around?
12 years.
13 years. I'm sure there's many tough years to say, what, you know, what is it gonna look like next year and stuff, but what, you never quit. And if you have that conviction in your heart that you're not gonna quit or you're never gonna give up, guess what? You're gonna continue to go on. They say that one formula for millionaires, you know what that is? They keep on doing the same thing over and over and they get really good at it. You know, that's how you wanna become. And then lastly, surround yourself with winners. You gotta have a good surrounding, right? All these mentors that are out there, they're giving their time and stuff with good hearts, right? They're professionals, they wanna do something good for the community. Surround yourself with winners, because whoever you hang out with, that's who you're gonna be. Okay, so that's just my little input, guys, for a little mentorship, guys. Okay. So, sushi chef, 30 years. Okay, sushi is basically an art form that was actually invented not in Japan, but in the peninsula, China, Korea, and Japan really honed it. And it comes from like 1,000 years ago. This is where it all started, okay? Japan, what they do is they take something and they refine it. They make it like a, you know, into perfectionism. So what Japan did was they basically took like a 3.5 month process of making sushi, and they did it in like, you know, in a fast amount of time. So, you know, you see this sushi rice right here. This is actually brown sushi rice, which is much more healthier. But this has vinegar in it, guys. Vinegar, sorry. Vinegar is the biggest thing that actually revolutionized sushi in Japan. Vinegar, adding vinegar. Before that, it was salt, it was cured. You know, do you guys think they had refrigeration back then in like 800 years ago? They didn't have electricity, right? So how did they keep the fish all like preserved and, you know, without rotting? They cured it. They put salt on it. They used heavy stones to kind of compact the fish and the rice. It would take like 3 months to make sushi. That's crazy, right? But Japan revolutionized that because they put vinegar in there in around 1500s or so with in conjunction with sumo wrestling, and that's how they revolutionized it, okay? So today I'm gonna show you a few different style of sushi. This is actually sashimi, thinly cut. This is more carpaccio style, more, you know, current version of sashimi. So I took a real thin slice of octopus that's boiled already. It's called mushidako. And I'm gonna put a little bit of a fancy salt on it. It's called the truffle, black truffle salt, okay? So I'm gonna put a little bit of that in there. And you know, cooking, guys, it's all from the heart. You don't measure things, right? But you gotta be able to taste things before you hit the thing. So I pretty much know how salty that would be if it was go into my mouth, okay? So it's all by heart, by touch. And usually it's olive oil, but this will be the grape seed oil that I'm gonna put on there. Carpaccio style is more like Italian style, okay? It's thinly sliced seafood or meat with usually olive oil. Okay, so I'm gonna put that on there. I'm gonna put a yuzu citrus on there. yuzu citrus is like a oriental mandarin. So I'm going to put a little yuzu citrus on there. So it has the, you know, flaxseed, the grapeseed oil and the yuzu kaju citrus, and it has the truffle salt on there. And I'm going to finish it off with the stinking peppercorn. Okay. All right, so who's never had octopus before? All right, you come on up here. Okay. And you guys have to taste it, you know? So this is about education and about experience. Okay, come with your hand. Okay, just chew well, guys, okay? Chew well, because it's a little chewy. Okay? Yeah, it's an octopus. Come on, guys.
The whole thing, yeah.
Yeah, just come on up. I just want them to taste this, you know?
Come sit down again so we all can
go out. Maybe I'll get to try it like a minute or two.
Here you go. Trini, you must.
Volunteers, you are also allowed to come.
He gave us a special treat.
Absolutely.
I'll grab you.
I'll wait for you to get yours and we'll do it together. You ready?
What do you guys think?
Thank you.
I'm going to learn about some more things.
Quinn,
thank you.
You guys are brave for trying. You guys are doing good trying.
I'm chewing. She hasn't gotten it around
yet. It's really good.
What up, up? Nice.
Maria, you're up.
Thank you. There's more. Please come try it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Three pieces left.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, guys, I'm gonna have more later. Okay.
It's really good.
That was an octopus carpaccio.
I'll just
continue a few more guys.
Okay, guys,
I'll sit down here. We got more to try. They all are a little different.
Okay, today, guys, you're going to have the maki sushi, which is a rolled sushi, okay? So it's going to be the spicy tuna California roll and the vegetarian. The kids are going to get a spam musubi. It's actually spam. So maybe you guys will like it or not.
Hawaiian
style. So let me take this beautiful tuna, guys.
Oh, look at
that. This is a big eye tuna. Okay, so tuna, guys, is like, you know, ahi red tuna. Do you know how big some of these get to?
Oh, yeah.
They get massive. Some of the bluefins coming out of the cold waters in like the Croatia or the Mediterranean, Spain, they can get up to like 1,000 pounds, you know, massive. It would actually go from here to all the way over there and it'd be like this thick. Yeah, it's something like that, or a shark or something, you know. But this one is a big eye. It's more of the Hawaiian or the Canadian. The big eyes are, this is probably, this one is not so big, so maybe it's 100-150 pound fish. But some of the ones that I get, the bluefins, the loins are like this thick, you know?
Wow.
So you can tell how big that fish is, okay?
What's
so
your favorite tuna to eat?
Favorite is, I love the bluefin is good.
Me too.
Bluefin is good, yeah. Okay, so how do I chop this tuna? Basically, you make it into a saku. So you measure with your four fingers, take a yanagi, it's a sashimi knife, and you slice it right through, okay? All right, so when you slice that through, in sushi, you gotta basically cut it in a more of a saku grip. So when you do that, you can get a nice piece out of there, maybe like 4 to 5 pieces out of this thing. All the adults are gonna go for this for sure.
Yeah.
You can tell this is a belly part, this is more of the fattier part. And then of course the back part, which is more leaner, is a darker red part. Okay, so all this I'm gonna use because, you know, guys, this one tuna right there, it's over $100, okay? So, you think it's not that, it's expensive or something? It's really not. A bluefin of that size would be double that. It would be 30 plus bucks. And of course, the belly for the bluefin, like this piece right here, would be like 25 bucks. $30 just for a bluefin.
Thank you.
Okay? Okay, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna torch one of these things. Okay, I'm gonna show you more of a current style. Okay. Back there. Thanks, sir. All right, so thank you. I'm gonna actually torch it. So it's actually called a seared tuna. Okay, so I'll take this torch. I'll take a little bit of the sesame oil. Okay, sesame oil. A little bit of the soy sauce.
That's the good torch.
Okay, soy sauce. So I'm gonna marinate it real quick. Okay. All right, so that you guys can see what's going on. All right, here we go. So this is a torch, I'm searing it. A little pepper would be good, like a black pepper, but this is called a tuna tataki, okay? And you know, once you do this, you wanna shock it in ice, but I don't have ice right now. I have an ice blanket, but.
Why do you do that?
Seared tataki gives a good flavor, and what do you call it? Usually you sear like an albacore because it's a very fragile thing, you know?
Why do you put it on ice?
Oh, shock it?
Yeah.
You gotta stop cooking. You wanna stop the cooking. You wanna basically stop the cooking because if it keeps on, you know, warming up and stuff, it'll go right through the tuna.
Got it.
Okay. So, anyway, now this thing. What's that?
How do you shock it? Is it ice water?
Ice water, yeah. You shock it in there and then for 15, 20 seconds and you put it on a paper towel. Okay, so this one is going to be the flavored tuna. And you see this knife is a yanagi knife, right? This is basically a sashimi sushi chef's knife where they use it most of the time. It's one side 90% sharp, 10% the other. It's like same as a samurai sword. This is a very basic knife, guys. But it's $300. Okay, there's knives that are $3,000, $4,000. It's ridiculous. Okay, but this is your life. You can travel with your knife anywhere in the world if you have the skill, right? And you can have a job tomorrow.
If the TSA lets you.
Okay, so I'm gonna cut that evenly, and I'm gonna have Andy. You can pass this out to those that want to taste it. You know.
Perfect. Yeah, we can sit down and Andy will.
Yeah, exactly. That's great. Okay. All right. So that's the tuna sashimi. Your tuna sashimi, okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
You can just pass this around. And I'm gonna put a little bit of hold on 1 second. I'm gonna put a little ponzu sauce on it.
Can you put this underneath?
Okay.
Pass
that around. Okay, so that was a seared tataki or tuna. Okay, guys? And let's see.
I said the question.
Yes, where's the question? Yes. Oh, okay. Alright, so let me show you guys how to do a tuna nigiri, and I'm gonna wrap it up real quick, guys. I know you guys are getting hungry.
We'll come to you guys.
They want a knife like that.
Okay, so what I'm doing here, guys, is I'm going to make a tuna nigiri. Okay. Tuna nigiri, guys. This is a freestyle sushi that they make in Tokyo. Just started in Tokyo. Okay. Water. I don't have water. Sorry. It's okay. Alright, so. Nigiri is basically rice and fish on top, right? Okay, so. You take a little rice and you mold it in your hand and you make nigiri like that, okay? So you go to a sushi bar, I don't know if you guys have been to a sushi bar, but if you sit in front of the chef, he can make you a fresh nigiri, or hand roll, or maki. You know, you guys notice that the brown rice is being used a lot more these days, right? Brown rice at Whole Foods, or, you know what's funny is you even go to some fast food places, they have brown rice as an option, you know? Flaming broiler, whoops. So basically, guys, a sushi chef is like a showman. They're like a bartender. Okay, they actually entertain. They gotta talk to the guests. You can't be nervous in front of a knife because, of course, it takes many years of practice. But you're like always on the stage, right? Because you're making this in front of people. Okay, so
does brown rice exist in Japan?
Yes, absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
That
was fun. Yeah. Absolutely.
Would you like to use that one? Yep. I'll pass it out to you.
Thank you. This is a tuna nigiri, and after this, guys, I'm gonna take a few questions, and we're gonna start passing out the lunch, and we're gonna eat. I know you guys are hungry. So how was the surfing today, guys?
Good.
Yeah. Good. Wow, that's
Ashley
awesome.
Stood up on her first.
Yeah. You know, my son loves sushi. Ashley doesn't touch sushi. She doesn't like sushi. What's that? Yeah. Okay, let's pass this around. I'm gonna put a little soy sauce.
Robert and stuff, you guys just had one of the other ones, so wait. If there's other, then you can.
If you have the seared piece.
If you already have another tuna piece,
I'd like you guys to wait. Well,
okay.
All right, who did not have seared? Let's.
Okay, guys, so.
Gather says there'll be more. If you miss it on this round, there will be more coming. This is a big bite.
Well, guys, let me just wrap it up, guys. Let me wrap it up. Yeah. Okay, so I want to thank all the volunteers, guys. You know, let's give a hand for all the volunteers, guys. I hope that one day, guys, the young people here will learn something to give back as well, okay? Because in life, if you want to truly be fulfilled, you got to give back. You can't keep it all for yourself, okay? So, before I end it, are there any questions that you guys may have?
I have a question. How did the vinegar revolutionize this? Is it because the vinegar was in the rice and it did something to the fish and they didn't have to process it the same?
Yeah, well, the vinegar acts as like a preservative, right? Okay. It's acidic. So what they did was when they put the vinegar into the rice, it holds the fish longer. It preserves it.
So they would make a roll with the rice and just preserve it within the rice?
Yes, oh, yes, okay. Yes. Okay. So that's how Japan did that, you know? Yes. You know, okay, let me put it this way. 1984 is that when I started. Yeah, and I don't know, it's just that you just do it like so many times. Repetition is the mother of all learning. Whatever you want to do, you got to practice and put the time into it. Now, do I do 20 hours every day right now? No, I'm using my brain more days these days now. I don't get to hold a knife all the time. I did that, I paid my dues, you know, in the behind the scenes, but now I don't, but it's practicing many, many, many times, yes.
Why do they say the sushi rice is the most important part of sushi? Why is the rice
because
so important?
Because if you have money and I have money and you have money, we can all buy the best fish, mm-hmm. Okay? This thing right here, the way you do the technique of the rice is all about how you wash it, what brand do you use, how long do you let it sit for, how much vinegar do you mix in it. It's just too much variable, right? So this thing will make or break a nigiri, a maki, whatever, you know. It's a technique, and it's your pride that goes into it, and you can, you know, make it more sweeter, more vinegary, however, right? And you can use a different brand of rice. You can use a cheap cow rose all the way up to tamanishiki, which is like five times more, you know? And it's all about the ingredients that you source, that you put together.
Very disrespectful.
How do you know? Well, you go to a Japanese-speaking chef, most of the time, they're using pretty good stuff. You know, it's the truth, you know? So you gotta try to stay true to your roots, you know? Guys, you know, life is a very fast track. I mean, you know, when you get to adulthood, when you have kids, life, it goes really fast, warp speed, right? But you know what, guys? Whatever your dreams are, your passion is, find out early, you know? Take action, you know? Persevere and surround yourself with good people, you know? Thank you very much, guys, for your time.